Here? Okay. Well, I'm Jackie Ring, and I'm with the National Center for State Courts. I'm the manager for Language Access Services, and it's particularly special for me to have Michelle Okun introduce me because I think we started working together about 10 years ago around court interpreter testing, and then evolved. And now I do language access, broader language access with the National Center for State Courts. And we are very fortunate to have Christina Yope with us as well. And
hi, I'm Christina, I'm an attorney. I worked at the San Francisco Superior Court for about 10 years, mostly doing self-help. And I'm also a certified interpreter. And now I do consulting both for the California Judicial Branch and also for the National Center for State Courts. It's nice to be here today.
Thank you. And I always say, Christina doesn't like it, but she's a triple threat because she's a federally certified court interpreter, which is really the highest credential out there. She's an attorney, and she worked for the San Francisco Superior Courts. So you get it all in one package. I guess before we start, we wanted to just get a feel from the audience participants about the language access services provided in your courts and what your role is. So just from a show of hands, those of you in here, who provides court interpreter services? Great. And then who provides services outside of the courtroom? Translation? Good. Okay, well, you guys can do the session, and then we'll just sit back. So that's great. I'll go ahead and, did you have any questions?
I'm curious, how many have formalized language access plans, either from the state or the local court level? Okay, so a fair number of you guys. Thanks.
And actually, how many of you are local courts, versus, and then how many of you are statewide AOC? So great. And one of the things we will talk about a bit today is we're seeing more and more language access planning at the local level, in addition to the statewide judicial council, AOC type levels. And so it's, I think, really interesting to see both sides of that. And we'll kind of broach that today. You did hear that we want audience participation. So as you go, ask us questions. So today, a few of the objectives. We want to talk about the range and appropriateness of language access services. And we are going to get into some practical tips and guidelines. And as I was mentioning, we're really focusing on language access outside of the courtroom for today, so not just court interpreting. A little bit about numbers. 8% of US residents 5 and older are LEP, so limited English proficiency. Most are immigrants, but 19% were born in the US, and we've seen an increase of 80% between 1990 to 2013. So that's really a major increase in LEP population. The largest increase, particular to languages, has been in Arabic, Urdu, Hindi, Chinese and Hmong, Gujarati and Persian. Now, most of you are probably seeing Spanish as your number one language. Is that true? So this is the largest increase within languages, but overall, the largest language in need is Spanish. This doesn't show up as well here, but the states with the largest population of speaking, those speaking a foreign language, are some of those, we call them gateway states, that had large immigrant populations from the beginning: California, New Mexico, Texas, Nevada, New Jersey, New York. You'll see Florida down here, Arizona. Hawaii actually has a very large population of foreign speakers. Illinois and Massachusetts, Connecticut and Rhode Island. Interestingly, where we're seeing the states with the largest percentage increase are some different states. So from 2010 to 2014, one of the states with the largest increase of foreign speakers, those who identify as speaking a language other than English in their home, is actually North Dakota, which I'm sure has a lot to do with some of the shifts in labor and job opportunities, but also Wyoming. Some of these are carryovers. Nevada, for instance, they've had immigration for many years. They're now continuing to have increase. And then we're seeing Oklahoma, Tennessee, Delaware, Oregon, Kentucky, Utah. You really see a span of languages. And from a language access planning perspective, one of the things that's very interesting about this is that we are seeing more and more requests, information, resource requests for states across the country. It used to be more the traditional immigration states. Now every state is really facing some of the language access needs in the courtroom because of these increases in population.
So why is language access critical? I think if you're all here, we're sort of preaching to the choir. But just to give us a little bit of context, of course, it ensures effective communication between LEP court users and the court, whether it's at a clerk's office, when an LEP court user is trying to file a document and move a case along, or in a courtroom where a judge may need to be able to communicate with the parties in order to get the information that they need to make a decision. The court system is the way to access and protect our rights. Without access to that system, the rights can become meaningless. In the theme of the conference, in terms of public trust and confidence with the courts, language access also is directly related to trust and confidence. In California, those of you who are from California may remember a 2005 public trust and confidence survey of the public and of attorneys. And for the public, what the survey found was that the strongest predictor of confidence and approval of the courts was in procedural justice, procedural fairness, not outcome, not whether somebody won or lost their case, but whether the process that they underwent to get through the court system was fair. And language access is a key component of that. You probably have seen this circulating since we recently had Martin Luther King Day,
Nothing like being live streamed.
I know. And being technologically incompetent. It's a bad combination. But if there's a problem with accessing any part of the court system, then it really threatens the ability of the court to deliver justice to everybody. Let's move on now to the practical aspects of why we're here. We're going to talk about services at the key points of contact. And it goes back to a question that Jackie asked initially, how many of you are providing interpreters in the courtroom? How many are providing language access outside of the courtroom? I think we're all pretty much aware of the need and ability to provide interpreters in a courtroom, but there are also court-ordered programs that might be part of the court proceeding. There might be mandatory mediation, mandatory settlement conferences, anything that's part of a court proceeding, there's a need to provide language access services there. Many of you might also provide bilingual staff at these critical points of contact, and I should say this terminology is used by the DOJ in their guidance in terms of the key points of contact where your court users come into contact most predominantly with the court. Clerk's offices, information desks, and self-help services if you have them, any kind of dispute resolution, court services, security screening, of course, that's probably the first point of contact for everybody with your court, jury services, and then post-judgment services. And I'm saying court operated because the court doesn't really have control over programs that are not operated by your court. You might be able to take into account contracts if you contract out for services with, whether it's a supervised visitation provider, a DUI program or something like that, you might be able to, in your contract, take into account their ability to provide language access services, but the court directly doesn't have control over those services. Other services at these points of contact can be done through translating information. Websites are becoming increasingly a point of contact for your court users with your court. Written materials that can be handed out at clerk's offices, self-help centers, your public recording phone lines, and documents like court forms. If you have court forms in your state or in your local courts, you might be translating those. Other tools, and we're going to talk about translation and all these tools in a little more detail in a bit, include iSpeak cards, which are cards that allow an LEP litigant to identify what language they speak so that you can secure the service for them, the interpreter. Multilingual videos and audio is increasingly being used given low literacy issues, both with English speakers and then speakers of other languages. Video remote assistance, which we'll talk more about later, that may include an interpreter or may just be direct assistance through video remote with bilingual staff. And form completion programs, which we'll also discuss in a little more detail.
Great. A little bit about qualifications. Most of you are probably familiar with the qualification process for court interpreters. Many interpreters do pass exams that test their ability for simultaneous, consecutive, and sight translation. And then they would also potentially have other requirements like compliance with orientation, background check, continuing education. And that is typically something that all of the states are doing some form of qualification process for court interpreters. Now, moving to bilingual court staff, not everybody is having a qualification process or implementing a qualification process for bilingual staff. And that could typically look like testing their actual language proficiency in order to perform the tasks that are important for their job. And language proficiency means that you would be testing them for English and the target foreign language, but they would not necessarily be tested for interpreting. So it's just to see what their proficiency level is. The language qualified translators, there is a recommendation to use qualified translators. The American Translators Association is typically the certifying body for many translators and for the languages needed for translation. There are some other entities, and some courts have local policies and procedures for qualifying translators. This is just a slide to show you why it's important to use qualified court interpreters. I don't know if I'll give it a minute. I don't know if any of you have done those shadowing exercises where English to English, and you try to, it's sometimes something offered for judicial training or bench officer training, and you'll try to simultaneously keep up with English in English, and it's extremely difficult. This is just a reflection of the criticality of accuracy. And I'm sure you've heard, if you've been in the language access world long enough, that the tests are very challenging, that nobody passes, that it's impossible. Well, the tests measure the job, and the job of court interpreting, the knowledge, skills, and abilities are extremely complex. It's very critical to have that accuracy, and as you can see, this is what you don't want to happen. Those individuals not qualified for formal legal settings, friends, relatives of the LEP party, minors at any point, the opposing party or other interested party, bilingual staff here that has not been tested, I'm not speaking about qualified bilingual staff who could provide appropriate services, but the bailiff or marshal or somebody who it may be bilingual would not be appropriate for formal legal settings. And then any other bilingual person in the area. So we've come a long way in language access, and this is an area where we have to continue to enforce that these are not appropriate individuals for bilingual assistance in formal legal settings. And this just goes through, why are they not qualified? As I talked about language proficiency, somebody may be bilingual, but they may not have the level of proficiency needed for that particular task. They may not have any interpreting technique, or it may be poor. They may not have the sufficient knowledge of legal terminology. And this is important because a lot of people do speak a second language, but all of us, we're English speakers who work in courts and probably don't understand at least 40% of the terminology thrown around, aside from the lawyers in the room. So the legal terminology is an extremely important aspect because even somebody who is completely bilingual may not have that legal terminology in the target foreign language. As we mentioned, minors never. We should never be using minors. And then again here, proficiency in a language does not equal interpreting. So just because somebody's bilingual does not mean that they can interpret. And it's almost like, you know, if you have to be bilingual to be able to interpret, but there's no way you can layer that piece onto just your bilingual skills. Here's just a little bit about some considerations for qualifying bilingual staff. The jobs can be very different for bilingual staff, and this is a consideration when you're doing local language access planning or even statewide planning. If you're going to do proficiency testing, you want to match to the job that's being done. So for instance, Spanish for a clerk's position who's at the counter may look very different than the level of Spanish that would be needed in self-help consultation or mediation, alternative dispute resolution. Where you're going to use your bilingual staff is very critical, and you need to understand what are the tasks that they are going to be expected to do and match the level of proficiency appropriately. Some courts are using stipends or bilingual pay differentials for bilingual individuals. One thing we see for other government entities is sometimes they'll use a percentage range, so like 10%. If 10% of the job will be in that target foreign language, then that may be a moment to consider bilingual differentials or stipends. Of course, that's something you'd always want to discuss with your HR and your payment policies, but that's a sort of standard cutoff that we've seen in some other entities. There may be some additional challenges for those individuals who you've assigned bilingual roles in the court. So from a court management perspective, it's important to note that sometimes the role can take longer to provide the bilingual assistance. They may end up being busier because particularly, you've probably sometimes seen this, when a language group finds out that there's someone available to help provide services, all of a sudden you make it a spike of LEP court users in that language. So it may end up making that person's job a little bit busier. It's also not always the case that they're going to know the terminology. Things can get complex in these court settings quickly, so it's always good to give the bilingual individual an out if they can recuse themselves, if something is getting too complex and they need the assistance of an interpreter in that case. Did you want to add anything to that?
What I think is one of the most important canons for interpreters, I think also applies here, which is the ability to sort of assess any impediments to performance, including your own limitations. And so I would really empower your bilingual staff to know when it's time to say, I can't do this, this is beyond me, without feeling like you're threatening their bilingualism. Mm-hmm. Because it is really important that they know they can really be doing a lot of damage. And it's not a reflection necessarily on their language skills. It may just be that they've reached, it could be particular dynamics with that litigant, or it could just be that they've reached a level that would be really unreasonable to expect of your bilingual staff members.
Mm-hmm. And you want to use them appropriately. If you've hired someone for the clerk's counter, and now all of a sudden today you've got a rush and you need them in self-help, they may not be able to handle that task. And again, that may be a proficiency difference in level. So you always want to use people in the appropriate manner and where you've expected them to work in their target language. Here's another good one.
This is my favorite one.
There's another one, I don't know if you've seen it, of a Starbucks sign, and it says exit here, and then the Spanish says éxito here. Yeah. And for those of you who speak Spanish, it means success. But it's a false cognate because it looks like the same word, but it's sort of like a, you know, American Idol line versus a Starbucks line. So Jackie's talked about the importance of having qualified translators and translations. And it's, as she talked about, is a different skill set. I was born and raised in Spain, was formally educated in Spanish. It's my first language. I'm very, very, very cautious if I agree to translate something because it really just requires incredible command of both languages and grammar, syntax, and it's really hard when you're primarily focusing on one language only. Like my dominant language now is English, even though my first language is Spanish. My primary language is English, and it's hard for me to sort of know whether I'm actually just switching from English into Spanish or whether it's really correct grammar in Spanish that I'm using. And you can get away with these things when you're orally interpreting, but it's much harder when you're putting a formal document together.
So you certify translators whenever possible. I know it's a luxury, that it's resource heavy and it's costly. So these are sort of best practices, and we'll try to find some suggestions for what to do if you can't get the resources to do it. But if you are going to use a certified translator, it's also important that you go in the direction in which the translation is going to happen. So the ATA, for example, that certifies translators, will certify the translator from English to Spanish, for example, not from Spanish to English. That's a different test, and it's a different process. So you have to make sure that if you are going to use a certified translator, that they're certified in the direction in which you need them to go, usually from English into the other language, unless it's a document for a case that's like a declaration or something that was written in another language and needs to be translated into English for the record. It's really important that you conduct, this should have a pointer somewhere, doesn't it? Oh, there it is. Legal review of translated content. One of the roles that I've done for a while with the California Judicial Council is review. So I won't do the translations. They hire a translation company to do it. But I'll do the legal review of a Spanish translation after it's happened. And it's because even the best translators they're not lawyers, so they may not know the legal terminology, and they could just get something slightly wrong. A term that seems innocuous could be really dangerous. And so it's really helpful if you have any attorneys, especially on staff, that speak the other language, or paralegals or clerks that are really familiar with the material, to have them review any translation that you send out, just to make sure that it's legally accurate. This is where I plug in, and we're going to talk about partners later, but community agencies can be really helpful for you here. Legal aid programs that may have attorneys that speak other languages. If you develop a relationship with them where you can use their translations, they might use yours, you pool resources, but one of the resources they can provide is sometimes the legal review of the documents and the translations that you do. If you are gonna use translations that you haven't produced, make sure that they're accurate. That's really important. Again, it comes in when you're picking up a translation from a community agency, make sure that it's actually accurate. And machine translation, more and more folks are using it. I really dislike it, but I also know that a lot of folks are using it. If you are gonna use it, I would, and I should say the DOJ in their guidelines really discourage its use. And if you are gonna use it, that might be helpful as a starting point. But then you need to have a human translator come in and fix it. And it will need fixing. Some courts, someone here from Orange County, they have a nifty, a lot of courts on their websites are putting in the Google Translate feature. What Orange County does, for example, which I would recommend doing, is that when you hit on the Translate button, it first pops up a disclaimer explaining what the problems with the Google Translate, with the machine translation, I shouldn't just pick on Google, it's everything, what the problems with the machine translation are. Some courts have that disclaimer, but just have it in English, which isn't very helpful. So make sure that it's translated, and make sure that it's translated by a human and not by the machine, because then it also won't be helpful, and you're just kind of compounding the problem. But Orange County has one where it's translated into whatever language you've selected to use. So if you're going to do that, use that. But just to give you an example, I keep hearing rumors that more and more folks, including legal services, are going to start using Google Translate or machine translation for some of their basic materials. And part of the argument is that, for example, for languages like Spanish, it's getting a lot stronger and it's much more accurate. So when someone was telling me this just 2 days ago, I decided to machine translate unlawful detainer to Spanish. And what I got back was the equivalent of illegal detention. Given this time of executive orders, on immigration, if you get a document that you think says illegal detention, right? So that's the danger. So just be aware of that. If you're translating directions to your courthouse, hopefully they get the prepositions right and it gets someone there. But if you're gonna get much more complicated than that, you really need to be very thoughtful about how you use machine translation. Who here has a translation protocol that they've adopted in their courts? These can be really helpful, and they don't have to be terribly complicated. California has a really complicated one, of course, that we worked on last year, and it's online if you want to use it as guidance. But the idea here is, one, to sort of identify which entities are responsible for translation. If you have a statewide system, your AOC might be in charge of doing a lot of the translations for forms and other materials, but locally you might have local forms or local materials you want to translate. One of the things that should be in your protocol is deciding what languages you're going to translate to. We put here 5+ sort of as a guidance, but really your data, your internal, your demographics and of your core are really going to determine what this is. And if you're a statewide agency, you need to make sure that you're that the languages you're targeting are the top five for every county. So in California, the top five are not the same for every county. So in order to kind of reach the top five for every county, you'll need to translate up to 9 or 10 languages. That might be the case in your jurisdictions too, or maybe that really you just have one or two languages that are so far above everything else and you have limited resources, and that's where you start. Another important fact to put in your translation protocol is a prioritization for translations. And the DOJ calls this sort of vital documents. But what are your vital documents that you need to translate? And documents, for example, that are very much, that are used for all case types. I mean, for, in California, that would be fee waivers. You file them for all civil cases. You would file a fee waiver. That seems like a pretty good document to target. Documents that inform you of your rights and responsibilities, like a summons, for example. Some courts have their summons are in English and Spanish side by side, sort of the big, you have 30 days to respond. If you don't, you may be in default and a judgment will be entered against you kind of thing, just kind of give people a heads up. Documents with that are in case types with a lot of self-represented litigants are important to have in your priority. A lot of courts just translate forms into 8 or 9 languages. My personal view is be careful with that because language forms are rarely understandable in English. So you want to put a lot of money into translating them into other languages that nobody's going to use. So sometimes it might be worth it and more cost effective to translate instructions for the forms and not the forms themselves. Another document assembly programs can be very helpful. Does everybody know what a document assembly program is? So instead of translating the forms, you translate the interviews for the programs so that the questions that are supposed to be in plain language to guide someone through how to complete a form, you put the invest the money in translating those questions. Very important to the degree that you can is that you start with plain language first before you, back to the issue of the forms, complicated forms, something that says nothing, that mean, you know, that people can't decipher in one language, they're not going to decipher in another. If you start with plain language in English, first you're helping your English speakers. And second of all, it'll make every translation that much more effective.
I want to add something. Just because this was a process we just went through and I thought it was really helpful, a lot of translation vendors actually will do a plain language translation for you as a starter, because one thing that doesn't work is sending it to the judges to do the plain language.
Yes.
Does not come out. Plain language. So sometimes actually it's a plain language translation that helps to get it into that plain English before you do it. And I just wanted to add that because yeah. I don't know that everybody knows that some vendors will actually do that as a translation project.
Yeah. And it'll just, I mean, again, it'll help all your court users. It won't just be for your LEP court users. And as much as you think your staff might get plain language, we all get used to the shorthand and we don't see it. You really need someone outside of the system to sort of be like, why do you say this word? It doesn't make any sense to me. And just have someone kind of question the decisions that you make around writing documents and instructions in particular. I made a mention, and we'll show you some examples in a second, but I mentioned sort of low literacy, both with our English speakers and also with our LEP speakers. So, to the extent that you can use more audio and video tools to get information across, that might be really helpful to reach a wider population. And again, we'll cover some examples in a second. We just finished doing for California a super, yeah.
Do you have any thoughts about
I call them case-specific documents, a letter to a judge, a formal, you know, birth certificate from Mexico, that kind of thing?
I think that's very important that you go through a certified translator. I mean, and in fact, I think that there's certification requirements. At least in California, I don't know how it works out in other states, an interpreter can certify those translations, which makes me uneasy, right? Because interpreters actually aren't tested in writing skills. But I would if you have to use an interpreter, just make sure that you use the most qualified interpreter you can find with experience. But I would say it has to be a certified or highly qualified translator. And in those kinds of cases, because it goes in the record, you have to make sure that it keeps, it's like interpreting, you have to keep the register of the document. So no plain language there. In whatever tone it's written, that's how it has to be kept through the translation process.
We also have debates about, is this appropriate for the court to translate? Mm-hmm. Is this a party's argument? Well, then is the party responsible for interpreting that?
Well, if it's something that would be in the court file or given to the judge in English, if it was submitted in English, then it would have to be the same thing for the other. Then you'd have to translate it. I mean, I think you wouldn't treat it any differently. You would say, would this make it to the judge if someone had just written it in English? If the answer is yes, then I think that your obligation is to then have it translated and have it be part of the court file. I went forward without meaning to. Okay, so we just did a project for California. David. David was very helpful in his court showing us around, but it was a project looking at signage and wayfinding. Before I started in this world, I had no idea what wayfinding was, but it really sort of gets at helping with your design and architecture and how you set up your court, helping users intuitively navigate the space, trying to reduce the need for signage, trying to reduce traffic in different spots, and sort of having more of a seamless movement throughout the courthouse. And it's hard to describe unless you've actually been in a courthouse that is set up that way, because then you realize that you kind of just found your way to the clerk's office without stopping everywhere, looking around, trying to figure out where you are. We put a report together for California that, as of last week, is public, because it's on the Judicial Council website. So you can see a lot of pictures and a lot of recommendations there about what might make good wayfinding. But some of the things we observed in David's courthouse is like this. It is space in a lobby before you make people go through security so that they can kind of orient themselves. Clearly, you know, delineated lines for going through, having high functioning offices or high volume functions in offices closer to the entrance, like clerk's offices, jury services. Open space so that someone can see the offices from where they are, so that they're not blocked by other signs or things in the way, so you can identify there's jury services, there's clerk's office. And sort of consistency in design. Of course, this is easy to say if you're about to build a new courthouse, right? Then you can just have your wish and tell them exactly what you want. It's much harder to do with older buildings that may not have had sort of self-represented litigants in mind, for one, which are increasingly coming to our courts, but also just kind of a more customer service approach to providing court services. And for that, you may need to, you know, work with signage and work with what you can to make movement a little bit easier. In terms of signs, so good wayfinding can reduce your need for signs. And one of the concerns from a lot of courts around signs is how many signs do you put up and in how many languages, and then people are not going to see any of the signs if you overwhelm them with signs. So it's really important that you kind of go through and try to figure out what are the critical functions and offices that litigants, LEP litigants, are going to need to get to, and how do you address it, and what are the languages that we want to target. And create a lot of flexibility, because offices change, programs move, you might even move to a different courthouse. So how do you make sure that you don't have a static sign that's going to cost you $10,000 that you can't replace? Electronic signage, which I will show you pictures in a second, seem to be pretty helpful, because they do have that element of flexibility, and it's easy to add languages. And as languages change in your communities, you can also just add new languages. One of the features that we saw in a lot of courthouses were these older and newer courthouses were these electronic queuing systems. And there's things you can do, and I'll show you in pictures in a second, that can help you take advantage of the screens and stuff that they have to provide information. One of the areas where we need a lot of work is in developing icons and symbols that don't have to be translated. You just have something recognized. Airports are great at this. Hospitals are great at this. I think services in the court are so specific that it's really hard to figure out how you would come up with that. But I would encourage us all to start getting creative and inventing them. And over time, people will start recognizing them. In California, we created a language access icon that the translators came up with. And we're trying to just get everybody to just use it everywhere so that that icon gets identified with, this is where you ask for an interpreter. And people start making that association with that icon. So start sort of figuring out what are like services that you need and what designs you can come up with and start using them. And people will catch on eventually. But it's definitely at the beginning stages still. So let me show you some pictures. This is from the project that we did from California. So here you can see, so the system that they use for electronic queuing is called Q-matic. And what it does is you go to a machine, it gives you a number, and then instead of having to wait in line to be served at the clerk's office, you can just wait in a waiting area. And so these screens, it's sort of like the DMV, these screens really are just intended at providing the number. So that you know when your number's going to get called and what window to go to. But what this court has done is used the rest of the screen to provide information. And this scrolls into English and Spanish and then other information. So here they're providing information on the Family Law Facilitator Program, which is a self-help program in California, letting folks know what case types, where to get information on the case types that they can get help with. Then the next screen provides resources for the Bar Association, for a local domestic violence agency. And so you can use these screens rotating to provide information for folks as they wait in English and in other languages. This is where you get the number for the Q-matic system. And as you can see, I don't know if you can actually read it, but these menus are in English and in Spanish. This courthouse has, Spanish is by far their second language. So they decided we're just going to target English and Spanish on this Q-matic system, and then folks will just get a number that they can just wait in the office for. This is a sign that uses some of the sort of icons that we've talked about. It was put out by the then Administrative Office of the Courts in California, now Judicial Council, and distributed to courts. Some courts use them, some don't. But this is something that, especially if you're at a statewide level, you might want to consider distributing for your courts and creating something like this that can be used and placed at courts. Probably the most used sign in all courthouses that we visited in California is this one. It's something that the Judicial Council just has done every year with a translation vendor. It's a holiday closure sign. It gets provided for all the holidays, and so every year, courts can just print these out and just put them throughout their courthouse to let people know, a week before. I mean, it's so simple, but it really makes a big difference. And it's not that, because once it's done once, all you got to do for the following years is just change the date because it falls on a different date. But it's pretty straightforward to do.
And these can be, I'm sorry, those could be customized based on, so you see there, it's using four different languages. But you could essentially customize that. And even from a statewide perspective, if you wanted to provide, like four or five options of the languages, that would be helpful. I would say one recommendation, and I don't know that you can see it on this one, is for your court staff to make sure you identify what languages are on there in English. Because that we always hear that. We're like, I don't even know what's on here. Yeah. So to just have some kind of
a footer
that says what the four or five languages are.
And that's a good note for all sort of brochures and everything, is even if you're going to have them all in another language, just have a footer that says what the title of the brochure is in English, so that court staff can actually use them and hand out the right brochure, because they all start looking the same. And this is the iSpeak card that I mentioned. You guys probably all use them or have them in your points of contact for folks to be able to identify. I know services like Language Line, for example, they will have in the communities in which they work a list of the most common ones in that state or in that community. When we were in Maine, they had a list of the top languages in Maine. Mm-hmm. For their iSpeak cards, although they call them language identification cards, I guess is the overall term.
And if you haven't used those before, the way that those are used is that the court user, assuming that they can recognize their language, is able to just point to the language, and that assists you with finding the right interpreter, in some cases, which may be telephonic, if it's at the counter. I mean, these are often used in counter situations. Where you may not be scheduling an interpreter right away, but you do need to get some assistance.
Finally, these are some resources to show you what some folks are doing with audio and visual multilingual tools. this, I mean, other, I think, jeez, keep hitting the wrong button. This video might just be helpful for you, especially if you have information desks or self-help centers where people can sit at or computers, to have that loaded for folks. It's a great video to just show people how to work with an interpreter, because as much training as staff and judges can have, the litigants still don't know how to work with an interpreter, so it's really helpful to give them kind of an idea of how that might go. The Judicial Council did a series of videos on resolving your dispute. They're in civil harassment, which is sort of our, it's restraining orders between people who don't have a relationship. Small claims, unlawful detainers, and debt collection. And the videos are divided, I mean, they're 15, 20 minutes long, they're divided into chapters. So it's helpful because it's like a 3 or 4 minute kind of bit of information, and they're translated into about 5 or 6 different languages. One of the tools, as simple as it seems, that actually is used a lot in California is, so the domestic violence forms, there's forms, but there's also information forms that explain how to use the forms and what the process is. What these form audios is simply someone reading the information form.
I need that for lots of things.
Well, and so it shows you how much, because people hit, I mean, and I do the Spanish recording for these, but and other people do the English recordings. They're super low budget, right? You just need to just sit there and read a form. Just get a staff person to read the information form. But folks who don't read or who want to read along while they're listening to it can access it. And you just post it on your website. It's just an easy link, and they can access that information. And we get a lot of hits on the Judicial Council website for these audio forms. LA has a great avatar, Gina, who speaks now 5 languages in addition to English, right?
Yes.
And helps folks negotiate their traffic ticket and what they need to do for traffic court. And so you can just go to lacourt.org, and you'll see Gina hanging out on the corner, and you just hit on Gina, and she'll kind of show you her skills. But so more and more courts. Okay.
The LA court website just crashed.
Oh, whoops. Oh, there's the website. I was like trying to remember. Guess the website's right there. Anyway, I checked Gina out.
Christina?
Yeah.
It turns out that Avatar program was quite cheap.
Yeah.
$40,000 or something like that.
Yeah. Snorri from LA, we actually wrote a little piece in the Self-Represented Litigation Network website, but it's actually, and then the translation is probably the most expensive, is having to translate the scripts. But it's true that it actually wasn't that expensive, and it's been written, right? The code has been written, so other courts in LA has, you know, offered a lot of this information already. So if you have that IT capability, think about exploring something like that.
I definitely recommend checking it out if you haven't seen it. It's just really visually it draws you in, and as an avatar, she's kind of guiding you through what you need to do. And I think just being able to provide that visual, it's pretty amazing.
And they now have her on buses.
Oh, right. Do they? Wow.
Very popular.
Gina. Well, if we have time, we'll try to bring it up online. It's pretty cool. To talk a little bit about video remote interpreting, this is definitely, as we're on this technology thread, is becoming more and more of technological solutions, and specifically video remote interpreting is becoming more of an option for courts. And there are a couple of scenarios for using VRI. You can have, you could be using it from a national perspective, and in that case you may be using an interpreter that's in a home office or a completely remote location. Or you may be working with, one possibility is even using an intra-state or intra-court solution, where you would use your own interpreters or interpreters that you contract with to come to your home court, provide video remote services to other courts in your state or county. And that is becoming an option because the courts can control one of the locations, the home court location. They already know the interpreters, they may contract with them frequently, and they can bring them in to provide that remote service. We are seeing the use more and more popular with two areas. One is if it's a language of lesser diffusion. So a language where you may not have the same resources and abilities to bring someone in person because the language is rare. You're having to find, you know, where can I get this person? They're three states over, or they're all the way up in the very northern reaches of your state, and bringing them in for appropriate settings may be the best option, particularly when it's a short, and Christina's gonna walk through that, but a short hearing type, arraignment or something where you just need to handle something very short and quick. We're also seeing the use of VRI for rural areas because in some states it's extremely difficult to get to the rural parts of the state. There's can be weather issues, there's snow, everything that can occur, you know, to make it difficult. So having that VRI option may really be a good way for you to still guarantee high quality interpreting, but with someone who's located somewhere else. We note here too that although I just was speaking specifically about court interpreting, you could be using VRI for other parts of your court services. So an example would be providing self-help sessions at one court. Maybe you have a Spanish day at in your self-help center. You could actually take that Spanish person, speaking person, and be able to provide those self-help services to other courts that may not have the same resources locally to serve their client base. So it doesn't have to just be something that you would think of for court interpreting. And I actually, if you're going to go and invest in money for technological solutions, the more options of use, the better. And we're specifically talking about language access, but obviously these can be used in other video conferencing settings in the court for different judicial procedures or proceedings. This is an example here of an intrastate solution. So the interpreter, which is the person with the blonde hair, is at one controlled court location, and she's providing video remote ASL, American Sign Language, to the LEP court user, who you can see is in another courtroom somewhere else. Here's an example of a receiver court. So this court, the interpreter is on the screen, and presumably one of these two people is the LEP court user. The ASL is in need of ASL. And this person is at a distant location. Couple key features here. It's not the greatest quality for the picture, but that person likely has a blue background behind them, something that's not distracting, that is easy. It's not taking away from the ASL that's being performed, and that it's high quality definition so that the LEP court user can really communicate. I mentioned that you can use it in different settings, but it can also be used just with bilingual staff because you may have, particularly in your urban areas, more bilingual staff who could be providing services. By having that video remote interconnectivity to different parts of your court system in the state or county may allow you to use trained bilingual staff more frequently, so they could actually be providing those services. And we see that you know, many courts already do that telephonically, and they have a kind of informal phone tree for when to use bilingual staff telephonically. Adding the video can just allow you to provide even more one-on-one communication between the LEP court user and that potentially trained bilingual staff. I think I already talked about using it for like a self-help center in one location, and it might spread out. Another option would be to use it at, for instance, if you do clinics, like a self-help clinic that's off-site. Some courts do provide clinics at a local community organization or community-based organization where they do partnerships. This might be a good way to also then provide the language services with trained bilingual staff who are at the court who could still be providing that service.
We're going to show you a video.
Is this the video?
Yeah.
courtesy of Bonnie Huff at, in California. It'll show you a free way in which I don't know how to use a computer.
This is
being rural, many of our sites are very far apart from each other geographically. So we like to use a video service to connect our offices so that we can speak to litigants and we can speak to each other as if we're there in real time.
All right, so now we're going to get started with the guardianship. So the first form is the GC-110. Everybody have that in front of them?
It works very well. We went through several machinations of different products, but we finally landed so far on a product called Zoom. It's a Skype-like product, but we actually like the sound quality and the video quality is very good. And as long as you have good sound and good video, you're able to capture everyone's attention in all the sites. We don't have bilingual staff in every one of our sites, but we're very fortunate and we have more than one bilingual staff in some of our sites. So what we're able to do is we keep that Zoom program going and live in all of our sites so that we can just speak to each other at any moment over the Zoom. And if we have a person that comes into, let's say, Clear Lake, and they want to speak to me, but they speak Spanish and I don't speak Spanish, I could walk that person into the room where the Zoom is going live and sit them in front of the camera and lean over and talk to one of my bilingual staff and have that person directly assist the person who speaks another language.
No, I don't speak Spanish. And she has some questions. Can you help us out today, please?
Sure. Hola, Susana. ¿Qué necesitaba el día de hoy?
Quería saber sobre
usted. We are also fortunate at this time we have someone who can translate not only English and Spanish, but Urdu and Punjabi. So those are some growing languages in our area, and so that is the way we're able to offer those services in all of our sites.
John, you probably know that Zoom is free, right? Zoom?
No, but
it's very low cost.
Very inexpensive.
And I think that I talked to Melanie, it's really like the hosting service itself, it's under $100. Is that?
It's something like $10 a month.
Yeah, that's what I thought. It's
sessions,
so. Do you use Zoom? Yeah.
We use it for video, remote, court mediation.
Mm-hmm. Right. So if you didn't hear, the gentleman said he uses it for court mediations, video remote court mediations, and it's about $14 a month. So that is what they're using to be able to provide bilingual assistance in a number of those very rural counties where they have staff and resources in one location, but here they can do it. And is that similar to how you use it as well? Yeah.
We're running low on time, so let me just go through. Jackie covered a lot of these already. One of the things to think about when you're using VRI is whether you have an in-person certified interpreter available. That's going to be your go-to, is an in-person certified interpreter. But if you have an in-person unqualified neighbor, but you have a remote certified qualified interpreter, then that, for example, seems like a great use for that. If you have an emergency that needs to be dealt with right away, if you have one interpreter that you need for four courtrooms, and there's one courtroom that maybe you're just doing arraignment, whereas the other ones are doing evidentiary hearings, those are situations where you can do that balancing act to figure out where your video remote interpreter might be best used. There aren't any official guidelines yet. One of the places you can go to look is the California did, and that's where the pictures came from, an ASL VRI pilot project, and they did a report with guidelines around when it's appropriate and when it's not appropriate and why. So you may want to look at that. There's also some really good research. There's very little research in general. There's some really helpful research out of Europe, out of the EU, and the use of video remote interpreters for cross-country sort of police interviews. But it gives you a sense of what the issues are for interpreters, because there are many. Being an interpreter, it scares me to think about doing a VRI event. But so you have to, as much as you can control, you should, and you should be aware of, and training is really important. So understanding technology is critical. Obviously, making sure that everybody can see each other clearly is critical.
This again, this is my thing. The impediments, the interpreter is remote, and in many cases they're only really going to have access visually to the person that they're interpreting for, unless you actually have a camera that shows all the actors in the courtroom. So the interpreters already have a hard time interrupting a proceeding to tell somebody to slow down or they didn't understand. So imagine if they're not even present in the courtroom. What the studies do show is that their sense of lack of control is actually much greater in VRI. And so is the insecurity about how to interrupt. And even though we're taught not to interrupt, there's times that you just have to. And if you can't see the judge, for example, or you can't tap the person to tell them to slow down or to just pause for a second, all of those things increase the stress level for interpreters, which is another reason why you probably want to have events be shorter, because the stress level, which of course impacts sort of the cognitive ability to do the interpreting job, gets really raised when you really have no control over the courtroom or anything that's happening. So just keep these things in mind. Make sure that everybody's trained on the pros and cons, because there are a lot of pros, but you just have to be aware of what the dangers are of using VRI. Quickly, branch education. Again, I think I'm probably preaching to the converted, but it's really important that all your judicial officers and your court staff understand what your language access plans are, what your language services that are available are. Working with interpreters and other language professionals is key for judicial officers in particular to understand, you know, what are the best practices in terms of using interpreters in the courtroom, team interpreting, how to establish credentials on the record. If someone's not licensed officially through the state, how do you do the voir dire? Bench cards can be really useful. If you don't have them, there's some floating around. There's also technical assistance through NCSC to help you develop bench cards for your judicial officers. And also sort of cheat sheets for staff about how to use this and how to set up an interpreted event.
I think because we're running low on time, maybe we'll go to the last slide. Just all of our slides are online.
Yeah.
And we are. I'm with the National Center for State Courts. Christina's a consultant with us.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you have any specific questions, you can certainly contact
us. Our emails are on the second slide.
If you go all the way back, our emails are there.
Yeah.
You can contact us and we'll be happy to talk to you about specific issues, things that really drill down into your local court or AOC perspectives.
And a lot, I mean, there's no point in reinventing the wheel. A lot of courts are working on these issues, on different aspects of them. You can find out courts that have a similar landscape to yours and see what they've done. See if you can borrow or improve upon what they've done. Like I said, there's translation protocols or action plans. There's all sorts of documents that different courts are working on. So before you undertake an incredible sort of writing research project, ask Jackie or us, to figure out, are there sort of places to start that people that have already gotten going on these things?
Our session is coming to an end, and I'm sure many of you have questions, and I know that the two of them will be available for a few minutes. If you want to ask questions, feel free to come on up and speak to either one of them. And I just want to say thank you very much. As Jackie said, I was administrator for interpreters in Los Angeles for 5 years, and just sitting here now, I even picked up a few tips from the two of them, so I know it was very worthwhile. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.